Welcome to the webinar. We've got Hot Hotel Tech today. And all I can say is you must have missed us. We've got 14 countries. We've got 500 plus registered guests. And we're delighted to have you with us. I'm David Johnson. I'm the CEO of Delivering Asia Communications. And this is the ongoing collaboration with C9 Hotelworks. We did 25 webinars for you last year. And we're kicking off today with a really our first one this year, and it's a really sensational topic. It's a masterclass, in fact, Hot Hotel Tech, a journey into the brave new world of disruption, innovation, and change. And we've got a lot of change makers who are our panelists today, and we're going to be looking at trends. We're going to be looking at the latest products. We're going to be looking at the emerging technologies. I mean, hospitality traditionally is a sector that is not being that tech savvy, hasn't moved that fast, certainly is not as fast as the tech world. So we need to catch up a little bit, and what better time to do it than now when we're still all struggling with COVID a little bit. So we've got some time on our hands. So we're going to have a series of presentations, and then after that, we're going to have about 10 or 15 minutes of Q&A. Please put in your questions as we go. There's a Q&A function. I'm going to collate those, and I will ask them individually to the panelists when everyone's done the presentation. So let's get going. We have Terence Ronson. He is the founder and managing director of PertLink. We have Ryan Parker, CEO and founder of Hotel Lobby. We have Roger Hughes, and who's the MD of Silstones. We've got Matt Carlisle. Matt is the Singapore Operations Manager of XCO2. We have Chris Snyder, Senior Vice President of APEC of IQware. And last but not least, we've got Bill Barnett, MD of C9 Hotelworks. Right, guys, without further ado, should we get going? Terence, over to you, please.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Okay, so when we talk about technology adoption and things like COVID and the impact on hospitality, one of those things that really has come to the forefront is the usage of apps. And everybody now uses QR codes for whatever they want to do, whether they want to do their smart banking, whether they want to look at a menu, whatever it is, QR codes have definitely come to the forefront. They disappeared for a while, but now they've come back. And when we talk about apps, I think the very important thing is, and of course you can study this screen later, the very important thing is the fact that we have to have integration between the different elements of the hotel operation. And when you're going out and you're looking for an app, make sure that you do have the full integration with your other systems. Of course, it's going to give you a contactless environment, but you want to make sure that it has mobile key built in. You can do digital ordering of menus, concierge linked to also the social networking sites. And most importantly, not only that, but you want to make sure that you can access the data and the usage of it so you can modify it later on. And I've just listed here a couple of companies that I've used examples of for their apps. There's lots of them out there in the marketplace, and these are just a couple of examples. But then, you know, whilst those companies may charge you so much per day, per room, or so much per month, per room, et cetera, you can actually build now a free app. And in these difficult times, you might say, oh, okay, maybe I just need something to tide me over. And there is a product by Glide Apps that you can simply take a Google spreadsheet and convert it into a mobile app. And I tell you, you can do it in about 10 minutes. It says 5 minutes, probably it's 10 minutes because of a little bit of a learning curve. And you can get yourself up and running with a free app. I actually built one. I built a couple of these during the last few months, and it's very, very useful to do that. And of course, the cost is very acceptable. Now, it's impossible to talk about apps without maybe one of the functions that's now being used for this, and this is translation. Translation has always been an issue within hospitality. We're a very global industry. Not everybody speaks every language out there. And at CES last week, and I'm going to refer to CES a few times during my presentation, at CES there was a startup, and this company is called Kotozuna. And what I'm just going to do is to run you through quickly their promotional video about their app.
Yeah, I'm in room 200. I'm locked out. Hello?
No te entiendo, disculpa, sorry. No, no English, no español.
Hello? Yeah, I'm in room 200. No, I'm locked out. I can't. Can you understand me?
¿Hablas español?
The language barrier is bigger than imagined. A virtual concierge service in your pocket. Translate your communication in over 100 languages. Concierge service adaptable to anyone from anywhere. Kodosuna.
The hospitality industry faces two challenges: contagious diseases in the short term, hopefully, and language barriers in the long term. With Kodosuna in-room, hotels no longer need in-room telephones and paper-based materials. Guests no longer have to meet staff physically to place service requests or ask any information. Messages between staff and guests are automatically translated. We use various machine translation engines and pick the best translation. Not only between English and Japanese, Kodosuna in-room translates more than 100 languages. This is how Kodosuna in-room works.
Hi, let me show you how Kodosuna in-room works between hotel staff and guests. The tablet on the left is by hotel staff, while the smartphone on the right is by guest. Guest can use Kodosuna in-room to request for any services using her own language. Staff gets notified of the request and receives the message in his own language as well. Messages are automatically translated for smoother communication. Chatbots are also used to boost staff productivity. For example, guests can use Kodosuna in-room to request for a cab through a chatbot. Kodosuna in-room is also useful for any room services, such as ordering meals and having them delivered to the room. Kodosuna in-room can stimulate a surge in guests, which means higher revenues for hotels.
Okay, so continuing on through this contactless theme that we're definitely seeing now happening within hotels, kiosks is another thing that's emerging. Instead of being the large, bulky, really ugly ATM type of devices that were prototyped in the beginning, there's now sleek devices. There are systems that can be custom built to suit you. So I just wanted to show you a few examples of how kiosks are taking over or will soon be implementing into hotels. Now, robots, is a fun thing. We love to talk about robots and the evolution of those robots. We're now seeing those come about for doing UV cleaning. We're seeing those coming into hotels for the sanitization process. And whilst they're good and they're okay to run around in vacant spaces and do that general cleaning, which could be quite labor intensive. There are issues with those. And those issues are that they don't cover all areas. They will do surfaces, they will go up to a certain level, but they won't really go underneath and get everywhere. But definitely we're seeing robots. Now in the bottom left-hand corner, you're seeing a prototype robot that was released last week by Samsung at CES. Which can be used for delivery purposes. Okay, it's bringing somebody a drink in a kind of work from home environment, but there is definitely the way it's evolving. And this particular robot can also be used for loading the dishwasher, serving food, et cetera, et cetera. Now, whilst we have seen robots in a lot of science fiction movies and how they all through their artificial intelligence become evil, a leading company, Boston Dynamics, have come up with a video that I'm gonna run now that tries to give them a sort of friendly face and make them more lovable than what they were.
You broke my heart, 'cause I couldn't dance. You didn't even want me around. And now I'm back to let you know I can really shake them down.
Do you love me? I can really move.
Do you love me?
I'm in the groove.
So I think that whilst, you know, it's fun to see robots dance, what it's showing you there is the flexibility that they can now create into a robot. The fact that it can stand on one leg, for example, and even jump over backwards, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, a particular technology that I do like is this from a company called the Simple Group. And it deals with sanitization of not only guest rooms, but also of public spaces, could be used within banquet rooms, churches, et cetera, classrooms. And what this particular product does is it has a small device that sits on a wall, which contains a canister of powder gas. And when the guest room is vacant, it interfaces to the door lock. It locks the door lock, and it then goes through a sanitization process of the room by emitting this gas. And it allows the gas to cover all the areas. In fact, it will even get underneath areas, something that the UV lights won't do. And after a period of time, and the gas has disappeared, it then, or vaporized, it then unlocks the guest room door and allows the guest to go back inside. It will at the same time send the guest a message on their mobile device to say, your room has now been sanitized and you can go back. But to me, not only that is a good thing, but the fact is it links to blockchain. And so there's a record of when the sanitization process took place. And therefore, if you need to do compliance and compliance with maybe a local government statute or code or something like that, it will record that and makes it available in a format that is unbreakable, if you like. So I very much like this kind of thing and see that happening for the future. So still remaining there, and I don't, although I don't want to talk too much about COVID, but the fact is it is with us and it's going to be with us for some time. It's now the evolution of something that we're seeing being developed called the COVID passport. Companies like Microsoft, Mayo Clinic, Oracle, and Google are trying to partner together to come up with this. And so whether you have a test or whether you have a vaccination, it would get recorded with inside this ecosystem. And then you would use that to buy an airplane ticket, to gain access to an airplane, to do whatever you want, and ultimately to check into a hotel. So why I'm bringing this up is the fact that while this is being developed, we need to think in hotels what we're going to do about PMS integration, because we will need to record this, the fact that somebody has checked in and they do have a COVID passport or a vaccination certificate, something we've not had to do in the past, but we will have to do in the future. So I'm hoping that through this, it will create some sort of awareness to the PMS companies that that's required. Now, sticking on the subject,
Terrence, very quickly, you've got about a minute left, okay?
Yes, sticking on the subject of PMS, I'd like, whilst there are a lot of new companies out there, one that was introduced recently by a company called Shiji Systems, you may want to take a look at, took them 5 years to build, cloud-based and very customer-centric with a lot of APIs built in. And what you may want to do after this session is to go to this YouTube link and listen to this five or so PMS companies who are talking about the necessity of integration of PMS, and also the fact that you can now do a lot of free trials of PMS because they're cloud-based. I've got a little video here about some of the other wellness things that we're gonna see as part of the COVID world, but I'll probably skip that one. And just move lastly onto this video, which is a futurist talking about hotels, hospitality, and travel.
We're going to be seeing this non-linearity of work when essentially time and space are becoming kind of more muffled, and we're not going to be experiencing life and work in the same manner.
Erica, what about travel? It's, for many of us, it's still hard to imagine getting on a plane again. When that finally happens, is it going to be different, do you think?
It's going to be different, and I see it playing out on both ends of the spectrum. And what I mean by that is we're going to see the growth of high-tech travel, and on the other end, we're going to see the growth of low-tech travel. So on the high-tech end, we see many more people being comfortable using these blended reality platforms, whether it's augmented reality or virtual reality, to immerse themselves in these far-flung places that they can't go to now, whether it's nature halfway across the world so that they can immerse themselves in something that is sensory and kind of delights all of our senses, but you can do it from the comfort of your own home. On the low-tech side, we're seeing many more people engage in kind of nostalgic acts of travel. They are packing up the family into an RV. They are taking cross-country trips. They are visiting the national parks. They are kind of going back to basics and just engaging in much more simplistic acts of travel. Right. So we're seeing both of these happen at the same time. We're going to be seeing this non-linear.
Okay, so I'll end the presentation there. Thank you very much. Apologies for my overrunning of time. When you get this video, you will see there's links to other things as well. And I'm happy to send out those videos to you also in full view.
Brilliant. Terence, thank you so much. Great forward future thinking there and practical stuff from Coach Zuma to friendly robots and really good stuff. Thanks. I'm going to move on. Ryan Parker. Ryan, what have you got for us, please?
Hi, guys. Good afternoon. Let me know what you think of that.
Yep, good to go.
Okay, so what we do at Hotel Lobby is we really specialize in, and what I'm going to talk about today is your direct booking platforms. And I'm just going to give you an overview. And, you know, it's really more of a review during like COVID about how we look at our direct platform and some of the messages and you know, how we, deliver our direct platform to potential guests. And how to encourage them to get over the threshold of booking so that we can, you know, combat the OTA issue and start to, you know, take ownership again of our brands. So it's very much going to be a quick guide. And like I say, most of the stuff I'll cover here today is nothing new. It's more of a recap on, you know, the things that we should be doing as new technologies come in and we start to spend more money. And as travelers come back, internationally, that we've got the basics right and that we're doing the basic things correct. So the first slide here, I just want to mention, why we need a direct strategy. A lot of our hotels, we have over 100 hotels with us.
Ryan, can I quickly interrupt you? Could you just expand your PPT, please, for full screen?
Sure. Is that right?
Yeah, that's great.
Okay. So the most obvious is to lower your acquisition costs, right, of direct booking. So with OTAs, it's getting very expensive, and as they take, you know, more and more control, it can get up to 30%. So most of our clients, we try to get them with their direct booking strategies through PPC and other channels, get that figure down to sort of 5-10%, so that there's much better margin on the rooms and the occupancy. Another great advantage of direct booking is obviously empowering your brand so that during COVID or if there's other future political issues, you know, that you can still maintain communication, you know, you can still have a narrative and a dialogue with potential guests, even if they're not traveling. You can keep them up to date with what's happening with the hotel, this kind of thing, so that when booking does return, you know, you're ahead already and you're not relying again on OTAs and other parties and other channels. You can really, you know, empower your brand with families and word of mouth and this kind of thing. The quality of guests is worth a mention as well with direct booking because, in particular, one of our hotels in Koh Lipe, Thailand, the quality of guests they get through OTAs is quite bad. You know, they tend to like share more people to a room than two or three. They won't spend money in the restaurants. They generally don't book excursions or, boats and this kind of thing. You know, they'll generally take bottles of whiskey and that kind of thing to their rooms, where if you have, you know, a better booking quality through your direct channels and your direct offers, you'll get longer stays and you'll get guests who will book special offers and excursions and this kind of thing. So that's worth a mention. And then again, communication and reach. So as you build your reach, it can only grow, you know, so through social and through, you know, your direct reach, returning guests, you can direct market to them again, which is, of course, cost effective in the long term strategy. A quick note here, by continuing to communicate with your guests now in the short term, create a positive ripple effect and benefit in the long term too. So that's just a quick mention on COVID, you know, that it, there's no reason to down tools right now. We should be, you know, looking to create connections and reach and building those connections during this downtime. And it's a great opportunity for that. Okay, moving swiftly on to talking about, you know, your direct platform and your website. 3 out of 4 shoppers, mostly, once they've found you on an OTA, will direct search your property website, your direct platform. So we can use OTAs as a great tool for marketing our own brands if we utilize it. But, you know, traditionally, conversions are only about 2% on a direct booking platform on your own website. So we look to improve that. You know, we want to be getting that up to 4 or 5%. And, you know, utilizing those people that are coming through the OTAs to look at your website as well. We do this, again, like what I'm going to mention is going back to basics for some of these things. Some of these things you'll have seen before. You know, they're pretty much sort of 101 basics of marketing in any industry, you know, and especially hospitality. But I think from our experience, the hotels that perform very well are the ones who really understand their USPs. You know, what, why are the guests going to the hotels? What are the benefits of that location or destination? You know, what are the facilities of their property that people are coming for? You know, and really understanding it rather than just being a hotel, you know, seeing it as a product and why, and understand why guests would choose your hotel over your competitors. And that moves on to the audience, you know, like, you know, if you understand your audience, whether it's families or, you know, golfers, which I'll talk about a little bit more, or romantic couples, if you know your audience and have a very clear understanding of that, you can direct your sales narrative to them directly. So it's a much more effective way to build your content and your direct strategy if you really understand your audience. Again, that ties into your message. You know, what are your messages? What is your hotel about? Why are people coming there? You know, what do people say about your hotel? And again, if you understand these things, then we can start to engineer your message correctly, and then we can start to market that through your direct platform. Choice. So not too much choice. A lot of hotels we see, you know, I think because attention spans are quite limited these days, you've got to cut out the fluff and the bump and, you know, the extra day here and the things that don't really matter and the things that don't really, you know, mean much to your guests. Just cut them out and stick to what do we do well? Who is our audience? You know, why are they coming here? How long are they staying? Where are they traveling from? What are the pain points? And really get back to basics, you know, to understanding, you know, the kind of 80-20 rule, if you like, of your hotel and, you know, where the 80% of the money is, and really focusing your marketing and your direct sales effort on those items. And again, you know, the benefits of direct booking, the price is obviously always the main thing. If they've looked at OTAs already, then you have to make sure you have price parity in most instances. So, you know, if they're comparing price from OTA to the direct website, you've got to make sure that yours is the best price or at least equal. Otherwise, they're just going to, you know, they're going to leave. Wi-Fi and, you know, welcome drinks. This kind of stuff's like boring. It's old hat. You know, it's to be expected anyway. And I think for direct booking, you've really got to give good value. So late checkout is great value for guests, because it gives them that extra day. We know that works. It's a really good incentive for getting them over the line to book. And free transfers is also a very good one. Takes away the pain points. It offers value. So, you know, these are the kind of, you know, value direct booking incentives that you need and not the kind of woolly, you know, old school stuff. You know, it's really getting back to basics, to what does the guest, where will the guest get value and why will they book direct rather than an OTA? So yeah, that's something worth considering. A couple of examples here. These are two hotels that we work on. They both share the same space, which is Chinatown in Bangkok, the Yararat Road. One is Shanghai Mansion, is very good. I use this as a good example. It's very direct. It tells you exactly what it is. Bangkok Chinatown's best boutique. So they're putting themselves out there as the best boutique hotel. They're authentic. They have trust signals. It's great imagery. It tells you what it is. It's romantic. It's for couples. And it does all that very simply. You know, it's all there. That landing page and that page we did, it hasn't changed for 6 years since we did it. And it performs very well because it doesn't need to change, because the message is very clear and it is what it is. And the hotel is very famous and it works. In the same space, one that's launched recently, a Dusit property that we worked on, Asai, I think this one doesn't work as well. It's a really kind of generic stock image of Chinatown. It's got like traffic jam, the backs of people's heads. There's no message. It doesn't really work. And I think if you look at the attention spans of people who are looking from OTA to direct, you've got to capture them now. This is the time that you need to capture that guest if you want to get them over the booking threshold. So a couple of examples there. Another one here is the Library New York. So I think you can clearly see by this, it's aimed at romantic couples, winter getaways, you've got trust signals, you've got TripAdvisor. Everything about this screenshot is engineered to get the shopper over the line into the booking engine, into a sale. Santaburi is a property we work with in Samui. Again, they've got a really bad video. It looks gloomy. It's not very exciting. It slows the website down. You know, it just doesn't, it's just not sexy. And it just doesn't, you know, encapsulate what the property is all about, because it's actually a fantastic property. It's a beautiful beachfront property, luxury villas, and it's got a great golf course. And it just doesn't say any of that. So I think, you know, what my talk about today is really going back to basics and understanding again what your USPs are, what are your messages, and getting that to your guests as quickly as possible.
Thanks, Ryan. You've got a couple of minutes, Ryan.
Yeah, I'll finish up now. I'll just briefly go over offers. Again, going back to the same things, focus your offers around your USPs. No fluff, you know, no bump. Make it worthwhile. Make it something that's relevant to your property. I'll move swiftly on to the examples. Again, Santaburi, although their landing page is bad, their offer is very good. Three rounds of golf for every stay if you stay 3 days, daily breakfast, and airport transfers. So really the big hitters. You're going for golf. You get free golf, you get your transfer, and you get your breakfast. These are things that are going to move guests over the booking threshold. Shanghai Mansion again. A lot of people go to Chinatown for the food, dim sum, the Peking duck, the crispy duck. So a lot of their offers are engineered around, what the guests are there for. So although it seems simple, I see a lot of hotels that do this very badly. So again, making it very simple. Why are the guests there? What are they coming for? Here's offers relevant to why you're making your booking decision to come here. Burasari room rate here. I just put this one on as a filler. $699, very simple, room only. The price, that's it. You know, cheap rooms during COVID, that's what you get. Here's a bad example. I'll use a sigh again. This offer here is for one night only, but I think by the time you've read it, your stay will be over. You know, there's conditions of conditions of conditions. And, you know, it's something about having a tour around Chinatown, and it's a lot of bump and blah, blah, blah. And I don't think this performs very well. You know, it's just not relevant. It's too much bump and it's expensive. You know, it's 6,500 baht for one night, and that's just for one room. Whereas this one does it very well. Koh Drum, one of the pain points of Koh Drum is the island itself is getting there. So all of their offers are based around free pickup and free transfer, you know, because it's relevant to their USPs, it's relevant to what they're doing. And then briefly to finish up, guys, you know, talking about meta search, and now you've optimized your direct sales platform. Like, now we need to get traffic to it. So you build traffic through the usual stuff, PPC, social networks, videos, that kind of thing. But I just want to mention it. I won't talk too much about it, but my advice is to, you know, make sure that your USPs and your sales strategy and messages are correct before you invest in PPC and meta search. Otherwise it's, you know, a waste, and you're not optimizing your budgets and your performance. And then the last thing is data. A lot of what we do here at Hotel Lobby is understanding data. So you can, you know, really turn the screw and really optimize to specific people, demographics, locations, and this kind of thing. But this is more advanced, you know, this is more advanced to what I've been talking about briefly in this 8 minutes. And then I'll quickly conclude. Get back to basics on your messages, your USPs, understanding your audience during COVID. You know, it's a great time to really go back to basics on that stuff. Engineer your sales literature around your audience and your USPs to keep it relevant. Again, offers that give real value, not just bump and fluff, something that's relevant to why your guests will be traveling to your hotel. And then optimizing your traffic, and then optimizing your data. And then that should really give you a really good, sound, direct strategy going forward once things reopen, hopefully sort of October, November.
Brian Parker, thank you very much indeed.
I tried to keep it, I tried to rattle it out. So,
no problem at all, but got some really fantastic and very relevant points there. No. Well, which is get to the point is one of the key ones. Cut through all the stuff. So it's fantastic. Guys, these are going to be all available to go through in more detail. There's going to be a recording, and this is going to be posted. And we'll send you a link immediately afterwards. By the way, all participants, there's a Q&A function. If you've got any direct questions, please, any questions at all, please put them into the Q&A function, and I'll ask them at the end. Right, we're going to move on. Roger, MD of Silstones. Over to you, Roger.
Yep, I'm here. Okay. Thank you very much. Welcome, everybody. I'm just going to open.
I think, Ryan, you need to pull your one down.
Sorry. Okay.
Done. Fabulous. Thank you.
All right. So let's see if I can now. Is it okay?
Yes, it's fine. Just make the screen larger. Just expand the screen. Done. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much for this time. I'm going to try to fit in the 8 minutes. So basically, the trend for 2021 have a common fact with the previous year, which is been driven by committed to sustainable development and sustainable architecture. So using recyclable materials, and in order to make sure that we have a self-efficient building, installation of all kinds to respect the environment, that's the main focus. So when you look at the picture from what we have today, and then where we want to go in order to be green. So to do that, of course, we need plenty element. So starting by architecture and design concept, so we can go further on the industrial concept in architecture. It's reducing cost a lot. So we can use, for example, raw ceiling, even with the M&E apparent. So with a combination of iron, wood, aluminium, and other elements such as recycled plastic also. So that can be good. The big things, that's the main focal point for the hotel today. I agree with Terence that previously hotels has not developed such a lot of technology, but it's coming big this year. I think COVID-19 might be also somehow responsible for that. So we talk a lot about the smart room and IoT. So IoT is Internet of Things. I'm not going to develop too much now. I will talk further below about it. So open multipurpose space. So specifically in lobby area, when you enter in a hotel now, of course, you don't want to enter in a commercial space. You want to feel like you come into a room. So meaning by all the element restaurant, all the F&B area, all the staff area as well, the reception area, all it's combined together in order to create a community. So just a brief parenthesis, in order to connect a community, to create a community, we need to make sure that when we design back of the house, we don't need to separate flow from staff and guests. We can mix all together. Why? Because that's a sense of a community, and guests want also to be able to chat with the staff on site and get some information, which for the staff, it's an advantage to collect data as well to please the guest. Another one big point on multi-space, on multi-purpose space, it's ballrooms. So ballrooms now require LED screen, like large LED screen. LG, Samsung are absolutely fabulous at that. So you can connect an amount of LED screen, and each screen can project different information, so which is good for corporate. But then you need to make sure that this can be transformed as a waiting room, as a sport event, or a car event, for example, as well. So you need a kitchen, an open kitchen inside, which can be closed and be transformed in just a meeting room or whatever element. An example we created a few years ago, 500 square rooms, plus an open kitchen with a multi-purpose area that we can transform easily. The cost was $6 million, and the ROI has been done on less than 3 years, which is, I think, pretty good. So bathroom area today are not treated only for personal needs. Now bathroom, when you come back from shop, you've been working a lot, you sweat, you've done exercise on the beach. So you want to spend more time and relaxing in the water, shower, having colors, can be red, can be green, and then you can watch as well on the mirror. You can watch the news through your magic mirror, which is available on the market everywhere now. And everything can be controlled also by voice control through the IoT, Internet of Things. So floors and walls in the bathroom, well, that nothing really rocket science here, but of course it needs to be easy for cleaning and maintenance. Minimalism in hotel is coming more and more, so which is saving lots of cost, and it's environmentally friendly, so this is good. Guests also now require less noise. Noise is a pollutant factor which affects everyone and everywhere in the world and every hotel. So that's why when we arrived at designing the rooms or meeting rooms, we need to make sure that we have good soundproofing. That work goes along with the M&E team and the IT team as well. So as previously mentioning the room technology, why smart room and why IoT becoming so important? Well, because a family of four, two adults and two kids, so they have at least two devices per person. So that's between 6 and 8 devices. So they want to connect easily everywhere. So, and they want to use their application through the room as well, which today they can, but tomorrow they're gonna be able to. So they will be able to control the TV, control the temperature of the air conditioning, close the curtains. So it's a very, very popular solution, which coming very big in the hotel. And also it has a great impact on the marketing perspective, because of the first who's gonna come on that market with the smart rooms will be totally disconnected in terms of technology. They will be so advanced, so that's great. And that gives to the owner the possibility as well to reduce the length of the ROI. So smart room and IoT for better experience. Of course, we collect data through all the smart room and IoT services. And then when the guests come back to his room, but it's easy for the operator to reset up the room exactly as he wants. We know what he wants for the breakfast. We know what kind of light he wants. We know what channel he likes. So people can easily, operator can easily set up the room for him before he arrives. And then, of course, big advantage, it's improving sustainability. because it's less cabling, it's lots of less things. So it's the biggest advantage of creating a smart hotel and reducing costs. That it's often associated to the concept. Also during the day, while it can reduce the amount of light and it can shut down or put or it can turn off, sorry, or turn on the air conditioning once you arrive at a certain temperature or if the room is not occupied at all. I invite you, by the way, are looking at Marriott Smart Room that you can find on YouTube. It's a very, very good example of what they can do with a smart room. So the advantage for the owner and operator, well, for the owner, it's reducing the length of ROI, of course. So to implement this smart technology, well, we will have, and it will become mandatory very soon. It has been starting on end of 2019. We will have to follow more closely the Kyoto Agreement and the Paris Agreement, which has been signed by the 195 countries. In hotel industry, in my last company, we did start to roll on the Paris Agreement in 2019. And inside, there's lots of things which come to benefit everybody. So it can be small, medium, or corporate company. So to do that properly, in order to bring along the right sustainability for the building, well, we need an amount of consultant, because the owner need to achieve and be successful on his ROI. So, and then we need to make sure that the operator will improve his energy consuming and improve his revenue. And that will result in a, I will call myself that, result in a win-win-win situation. The third win, it's for the staff, because that will benefit the staff as well. So definitely that. So of course you need architects specialized in sustainable development. You need interior designers specialized in sustainability as well and familiar with this international code. That's very important. So one key factor also, it's the project manager. It's crucial to have a project manager. He's the one who's going to be able to coordinate all the different components on site in order to make sure that we bring along a hotel fully properly operational. So that's very important. As the construction manager, it's the same thing. And today there is very easy project or construction manager software to use. There's application as well, user friendly, which can be on the cloud and can be delivered to anyone and can be open on your phone, on your tablet and on and on. So construction can go faster. We can gain on time, which reduce cost as well. So you need the lighting designer, landscape designer. It's extremely important to have the landscape designer, especially now if you want to be sustainable, because he's the one who will be very flexible with international sustainability programs. Food and beverage consultant, it's very important to take an F&B consultant on board, because for information, about 30% of all produced food are wasted. So it's a major issue which costs billions to the world, we know that, but then we can have a big impact in hotel industry by reducing that using technology that the IT and the M&E guys can offer. Kitchen designer, well, those guys are usually well connected with a sustainable development, because they have to be aware of what material they can use, otherwise they can get sanctioned depending on where they are. But if they are an international company, that can happen. So those two guys, the F&B and the kitchen designer, have to work closely. They cannot work apart. Wellness spa and consultant, it's more than just a foot massage and the treatment room. It needs to have colors, it needs to have showers with multi-jet, and different type of material as well. It need to have hammam, these kind of things. That's what's gonna attract the guest, and that's what's gonna give the benefit to the operator in order to make more revenue. Art and prop consultant, it's extremely important to have. The last hotel I have done, it's Pullman in Khaolak. And so we had a fantastic art and props local from Thailand using recycling material, very, very smart, and they have done absolutely a beautiful project. So this is all the benefit for the owner to put, to do art and props, because that's creating revenue. Nothing to see with technology, but more with how to create a proper community. So I'm coming now. So these two parts are for me the two important, most important, I would say. It's the M&E MEP team and the IT. So these two
we've got about 1 minute left, Roger.
Okay, so these two guys need to work very closely, basically. So I go to the last thing. Wi-Fi today are becoming less and less efficient due to the demand of data required by the guest. So there's an answer to that. There's a new system coming very strongly. It's Li-Fi. So Li-Fi basically, it's connect through ultraviolet, infrared, visible light communication, LED system. So if you look on the little picture on the right-hand side of the presentation, you will see the phone, you will see the LED. So now from the router going through the signal of the LED, we will be able to connect to your phone. And to give you an example, from 100 megabytes that you will have from the router, if you have like 10 bulbs LED on your ceiling, well, you're going to go up to 300 to 400 megabytes. So it's a question, you will be able to download movies in a question of minutes, but like gigabytes of downloading, which we cannot do at all with a Wi-Fi. Unless you have a Tarzan router in the same room, maybe. And so just the last example, Philips has developed this VLC system in their shop. And so when the guests come in their shop, so they download an application on their smartphone and it works, it starts working straight away through the LED bulb. So the good thing is the LED can pinpoint where the guests are located in the store in order to give them and then corresponding information based on which halls and where they are looking at and what they are looking at. So that's good to collect the data in order to offer the best experience to the guests. And then to finalize, so design for energy efficiency, low environment impact, waste reduction, longevity and flexibility, healthy environment, and get a better ROI for the owner if everything has been set properly from the right beginning. Thank you very much.
Brilliant. Roger, thank you so much. Some really, really great stuff. And then I'm sorry to hurry at the end, but I mean, come on, Li-Fi. This is what you're learning on the DAC C9 webinar series. Roger, thanks so much for your input.
I can give more information about that if it's required.
Fantastic. We're going to move on. Matt Carlisle, XCO2. Matt, are you with us?
I am, David. Let me just do a quick check. Is my screen showing up correctly?
Yeah, that was record speed. Thank you very much.
Smooth as silk. Everyone, David, thanks very much for inviting us to take part. So I'm going to throw at you 8 tech ideas for sustainability and energy in hotels and resorts. And like my other presenters, these are intended to spark your interest, to get you thinking about what could be implemented on your property or properties. So a little bit, briefly, XCO2 is an MEP and sustainability consultancy. And so we've been working in hospitality for over 12 years now. And working across both design and existing properties. And so our team here in Singapore and our colleagues in London see and research plenty of interesting energy and sustainability ideas. And it was really cool actually to see David, Roger's list that he had at the end there, just about like how important it is to have a team that's actually working cohesively to get a sustainable product. So what are our 8 ideas? So number 1, virtual metering, leveraging big data. So hopefully everyone who is interested in efficiency, saving energy, saving water, reducing your footprint will understand the value of metering. Measuring and tracking your utilities is the first step in reduction. So you need to know how big the problem is before you can solve it. But what if you don't have any meters? So either because your property is a little bit older, or the budgets were cut during construction, or you currently just don't have the capex, or you don't want to wait till next year to get the budget to do it. Well, this company, Dexma, have come up with an interesting solution. So they take their large database of real metered buildings and they developed a predictive modeling algorithm. So if you provide them with some information about your building, so the topology, the location, the occupancy, and crucially, the utility bills, they can produce an estimated breakdown of what your energy usage will be. So lighting, cooling, hot water, you name it. The premise being that like magnitudes change between properties, but profiles are more consistent. So while you don't get anything that's quite as consistent as quite as accurate as real metering, it can give you a place to start with. So you can start making plans whilst you're getting the correct metering in place. So the second one, AR and VR, digitizing sustainability interaction. So all the operators we work with, all of them are keen for their guests to know and learn about and take part of their sustainability journey. You know, learn about what they're doing to reduce their impact. Now, depending on your property, so say you're a hotel tower in downtown Jakarta, because of your location, you might be quite limited to what you can show a guest on site or even what you can do on site. You simply just don't have the space for an urban farm or for a large PV array. But it could be that you're doing all this good stuff, you're just doing it offsite. So AR and VR provide an amazing platform for your guests to have an immersive, interactive touch point with your sustainability journey. So they can visit the community programs that you sponsor, they could see your hotel chain. Hell, they could even go into your basement and see where your team is diligently separating all their waste into separate recycling streams. And when they can see that they're doing it, they'll believe in your brand. So it's an opportunity here to leverage technology to get better interaction with your guests. Number three, pack and track to reusable packaging. So many owners and managers talk about and stress how their business model for hotels, especially their F&B departments, have had to adapt during the COVID era. So you have, you know, hotel restaurants, cafes, kitchens that are on Deliveroo, Grab, Food Panda, you know, all in an effort to drive revenue, to create value. So there's a five-star hotel here in Singapore, on Orchard Road, and they were selling like some of the best burgers in Singapore during the COVID break. So it shows that this is a bit of a shift perhaps of how we'll see hotels operating. And while this is still new, why start with old ways of thinking? So using disposable packaging. Trackable and reusable container companies are popping up all over Asia and the rest of the world. So Muse is now in three countries, Taiwan's getting involved. So you can use it as an opportunity to start fresh. So if these companies aren't within your city at the moment, means speak to your colleagues in the restaurant, cafe and hotel business. You know, see if they want to get involved. These companies will want to be here. They just need the critical mass. So number four, innovative funding, making renewables affordable. So again, pretty much everyone agrees that renewable energy is the future and we need to accelerate the adoption to limit climate change. I mean, there's one guy that I can think of that doesn't think like that, but you know, it's his last day of work today, so we don't have to worry about him anymore. But like I said, most clients want to have on-site renewables or upgrade their MEP systems to more efficient versions. But CapEx is a barrier. So enter like funding innovations that can help. So EDGE is a certification scheme that gives you access to funding for efficiency and renewable installations. So once you get accredited, you can get access to cheap capital. PPAs are power purchasing agreements where the company pays for the installation of the equipment and then charges you back for the electricity produced or indeed the energy that you use. Usually at the end of the agreement, the equipment title is transferred to the property owner. So these are two options where you can lower the barriers you've got to reducing your energy and making your site more energy efficient. Number five, so recycling gamification, technology and nudge theory. So what we've learned about people is that in order to enact change, like even if they know rationally what the correct thing to do is, it helps if you can like tip the scales to make the right kinds of behavior fun, like give them a little nudge. So many of these examples are taken from the education sector and local municipalities, but the principles can be applied to hotels. So for example, Throwwise is a token system where you have to use these tokens to use specific bins. And on the schools that implemented, they saw like a 30% increase in basically recycling quality, like quality of separation. You can see the one there, you can vote with your cigarette butt, whether you think Messi or Ronaldo is the greatest of all time. So again, trying to make it a little bit fun. Yeah, there's even the bin that you can see there in the top right-hand corner, which is essentially a game of Tetris. So within your hotel, within your company, get your team together, have a think about how you can gamify the right type of behavior. Like it'll be fun. Number six, package STP units, creating a water cycle within your property. So this is one we've talked about before. So water is a precious resource, but we treat it like garbage. We throw it down the drain. So by using these packaged on-site water treatment plants, you can process and reuse all of that water within your property. You can create a water cycle. Now, this is probably pretty obvious to a lot of the people online today that work in resorts, where there's a lot more space. You see lots of these, particularly around Asia, when there isn't a, you know, a municipal source there. But package systems can be installed in the basements and plant rooms of urban hotels. They're compact, and if they're managed well, there's no negative guest impact. So, and a lot of people say, look, we don't really have space. But I mean, if you're in an urban hotel, I mean, when was the last time your car park was 100% full? So you just need to look at opportunities of where you can put this in. And speaking of cars and car parks, electric vehicles, green hotel transport. Oh, Ryan's had enough, he's off. electric vehicles, EVs are finally here. So like Tesla is the most valuable company in the world at the moment. You know, NIO, a China brand, has the same market cap as General Motors as of yesterday. And EV sales are up, so I think 25% over the last 5 years. So you need to look at your options for going electric. You know, cars, boats, buggies. I mean, both buggies are electric anyway. But within your site, you should be looking at having an EV charging point. Yeah, this is something that your guests might remember, particularly if at the moment during COVID, you're hiring out your hotel rooms as offices for people. You're going to get more local staff. And so our last of our eight ideas, which everyone has tried to avoid, but basically is, you know, unavoidable, is COVID changes to your HVAC system. And Roger probably touched on this a little bit. And because it's the new normal, I wanted to have something in here. So most big HVAC companies now are providing upgraded filters, UV sterilization and ventilation packages to make the hotel safe. So this is a Daikin example you can see here on the left. They're also doing package systems for UV sterilization within ductwork. And indeed, a lot of companies now have these packaged fan systems so you can up the ventilation rate in hotels depending on whether you've had an infection or not. So the majority can be retrofitted to existing hotels or installed on new properties. So guys, that's pretty much it for me, is for our eight hot hotel tech ideas, Mac, for engine sustainability.
Thank you, Matt Carlisle, just bang on time and really like that stuff. I've heard Chinacation, I've heard Californication, but gamification, really like that, making stuff fun. Thanks very much, everyone. This is going to be obviously online after this too. You can have a much closer look at these slides. We're moving to Chris Snyder. Chris, you with us? Hello, Chris. Hi, Chris. I can't hear you, Chris.
Sorry.
Oh, there we go. On you.
Brilliant. No problem with my mute.
Are we good to go now?
Absolutely. That's a problem I don't normally have, is people hearing me. So great to be here, and I hope you're all having an amazing day. Thanks. Been some really good presentations. What I like to say is that anything that you like here that I say is definitely because of Bill and David. Thank you for that. Anything you don't like is solely from me. I don't necessarily look for people to agree with me. I think that if you're in a room and there's more than one people and both agree on a plan of action, then someone's not thinking. So with that being said, there's no way to really give feedback to me directly right now, but for the Q&A, let me try and start. Hot hotel tech, there's a lot to really peel through here. And I thought one of the best ways to do this was to look at this from the hotel perspective in terms of what technology can you use to better help to manage and build your business. And then the second part is, what technology exists to help you to manage your business from home and also to communicate to not only your customers, but to the people who work for you, the people who have to go out and get the customers and so forth. So I'd like to go under the premise that technology is your bullhorn. And as I go on to the next slide here, one of the things I was looking at was how can hotel owners or operators work from home? How can your third party systems enable a business that never closes? And how can you connect to people, your people and your systems? So I really want to sum that up in just three different statements. The first is, overall, technology is your bullhorn. The most important thing that I could tell you right now is, if it takes you as a business leader more than 30 seconds to 1 minute to get your company's revenues, projections, and your expectations. If it takes you more than a minute, you've got the wrong system. It's just, you know, when you all built or created your own businesses, did you ever sit down and think to yourself, you know what, I want to have a business where it takes me 1 week to 2 weeks to figure out how much revenue I have on the books, how much revenue has canceled over the last 24 hours. If you don't have a cloud-based PMS and you don't have a system, not just necessarily a PMS, but a cloud-based system that allows you to roll up your revenues, your profitabilities, to allow you to instantly access your data, then I'm sorry, but you're back still when hotels first came into being, which would have been 2500 BC in the Phoenician Empire. So we like to talk about technology, and the very first concept of a hotel happened in 2500 BC in the Phoenician Empire. And that was people renting rooms out of their houses. Fast forward to the 21st century, and everybody was impressed with this new technology called Airbnb, which allowed people to rent rooms in people's houses. So technology is good. Allow it to be your bullhorn. There are systems that you can use that will enhance your leadership, your ownership management, and your two-way communication. You need to be careful about what you use, because just like today, we are on a channel which allows us to talk to people in 14 different countries. As I said earlier, I don't expect everyone to agree with me, and I don't necessarily think that that's a bad thing. But you need to be able to choose your systems that you're using wisely and understand who your audience is and the message that you wish to push to your audience. Some of the things that I'd like you to keep in mind when you're looking at a cloud-based system is it will allow you to roll up all of your different brands, all of your different hotels, your resorts, everything. If you have timeshare and condo service departments, to resorts, and will allow you to propagate rates and promotions up and down and bookings up and down, so that in an instant, you as a head of a corporation can have access to all the data that you need. Your hotel or your resort over the last several years has come to be a home away from home to your guests. So as you know, when you all travel, you have certain expectations. Those particular technology items that we talked about here today that were shared with us are great ways to take a look at what do the room of the future need to look like, and how can you as business owners and managers help to be ahead of that technology curve. Finally, in terms of who's responsible for your innovation, I look at that and I believe that every person who works in the organization should be responsible for innovation. From the person, who better than to innovate a better way to clean a room than your housekeepers? Certainly, you know, they are part of that process, and they need to be part of the solution of how it becomes better. And that applies to everyone. When we talk about technology, I know some of these particular items on here are quite old, but the reality is there are so many ways to communicate that, quite frankly, it just makes Snyderman spin. There's so many ways to communicate. I think the important thing is for everyone to understand who you're communicating to. There are primarily four different personality and communication styles: the analyzer, the relator, the director, and the initiator. And the interesting thing about this is, on this particular call, there are so many different personalities and communications, styles, that some people might actually enjoy my personality style right now and some might not. That's absolutely good. I think that's, you know, I'm not sure that I can meet everyone's particular expectations, but when it comes to personality and communication styles, I would say the best thing is to take a look at the audiences that you're using. So in this particular example, you have four different types, but based upon the fact that you can be an analyzer and a director in terms of your personality and your communication style doesn't have to be the same. You can end up with as many as 16 different variables on each person, or four different variables on each person that's here. Yet somehow, as a communicator and using technology, we need to be able to satisfy everyone's needs and perceptions. The ability to communicate across the globe is just amazing. And it's just going to, I believe, grow exponentially. And you see things like the Li-Fi, you know, what's next, right? So when I wanted to break this down by taking a look at, first, you need to understand what is your message and what are you saying? Then your audience. So who is your audience? And who are you speaking to? Then your medium. How are you saying it? Where are you saying it? How are people attending? All those ultimately come up to your message strategy, which is, what do I want you to take away? And that being said, what I'm hoping that you would take away from this is that technology is your bullhorn. And I want to show you a YouTube video, just a few moments, because I think that this YouTube video has a lot of great communication methods to it. And in some cases, this might be a person that you already know.
Chris, we got about a minute, okay?
Sorry?
We've got about a minute left for you.
Okay, I've got like 30 seconds on this video.
Okay, thanks.
So here's a great video, and the reason I stopped it here is in just in 25 seconds, you kind of personally already get to know who Craig is. He's a guy who rides a motorcycle to work. The interviewer you can't see. So you actually, as a viewer, take the place of the interviewer. So within 30 seconds, you actually get a taste or a flavor of who Craig is and what he is like. The video goes on more and you'll be able to see it within the rest of the communication. One final message that I want to go through, you could technically have all the correct audience, message, communication, and strategy, but you could still end up having the wrong result. And what I want to show you now just briefly is where that has actually happened in real life in the past. So in this particular case, the audience was senior directors and managers for NASA. The message was space shuttles and parts shouldn't be launched in cold weather. The medium was conference calls and face-to-face meetings. And the goal was to hold the launch until they could guarantee a better future. So the message, everything was there, but unfortunately, this still happened. People are fallible. I just want to leave you with the fact that technology helps people to communicate. the communication makes the decisions you need. They don't make the decisions you need to make. They enable you to communicate those decisions, but you still have the responsibility for the communication and the result. And thank you.
Excellent. Thanks very much, Chris. Superb. Guys, we've gone over time today. I'm going to pass this over to Bill Barnett at C9, and Bill's going to show us some stuff, and he's going to wrap things up. Bill, over to you, please.
Hi, David. Thanks so much. And the one thing we've learned from this webinar today is like life. Life is imperfect. It's frayed. Sometimes it's a fuck up, right? You know, this is what happens. And technology is the same way, as we've seen today, right? It's imperfect, but that's why it's good to look at all these different elements and understand this is part of the process again. So, you know, technology is not going to solve all your problems, but it certainly do a lot of things. And one thing we know about the hotel business is we don't dream about how much things we can do about our business with technology. I believe we don't really capitalize on technology at all. You know, when we go back, I think let's go back to those great inventions. Who remembers the bedside control panel or that fax machine? 2 o'clock in the morning, you're sitting in your wide asleep in your room and the fax machine goes off, right? Because somebody's faxed you from overseas or something else. You know, of course that iPod docking station and the telephones, who the hell needs a telephone? I've got a telephone right here. I've got a clock right here. You can wear a watch. Why do you need all these superfluous things? And for a hotel owner, I think when you go backwards, what do you want to invest in technology? And I think that's really critical going forward in the years ahead, especially post COVID, because money matters. There's so much technology. How much technology can guests bring on their own that they can adapt in their room? And I think probably for me, it's not just the hard technology in a guest room, but it's how the guest room is going to change. And I think that's kind of the intriguing part, because too often we have brand standards, right? You know, this is a great example of, you know, the brand standards. You got the Nike there, right? You got the kid pissing on the wall, right? Because at the end of the day, you can have brand standards, but are they really relevant? I think the good thing as we come out and talk about soft brands and everything else is we're seeing less cookie cutter hotels. We're seeing less influence of brand standards on hotels and guests who want something a little different. So thank God we're past that cookie cutter club sandwich stage. You know, I think that's key. But when I go back to technology about how technology could be used, I go back to digital projection systems. I can see in the future when you look at a guest room, you know, the ceiling is not used in a guest room. What a great opportunity. You've got a big white space up there. Why can't we use that for technology? Why can't designers do something with that space, which makes it practical? You know, why do we have to have artwork at all in a guest room? Why can't we have artwork that where you can customize that, where you can do different things? I think the outcrop of today's technology also is with 3D printing, construction methodology, is it's going to change design. I think that's one of the better uses of technology, because at the end of the day, a guest is going to bring their own phone. They're going to bring their own technology to the hotel as well. Well, maybe you should be investing in technology which goes back to design and goes back to improving the guest experience where you can see and feel it and innovative things. I think that's really important. You know, there's always go backwards. I always go back to the Henry Ford thing and said, you know, if you ask people what they wanted, they would have said faster horses. You know, at the end of the day, you've got to think your own way. You've got to think what is that future trend going to be, and take a gamble. You can't rely on what everybody else is doing in hotels. So I think that's really the theme of today. One reminder about today's session, we've had lots of presentations and great presenters. They all spent a lot of time putting presentations. We're going to be sending each and everybody who attended this a list of those presentations you can download. We encourage you to have dialogues with all these gentlemen. They've had great knowledge and everything else. So please continue the dialogue from these sessions. This is a discussion. This is a class presentation. It's to educate. So please connect on LinkedIn with these presenters. Ask them questions as well. And one great thing about today is today's a great day because it's the dawn of a new era in my country, America. And I think that's a great thing, because as we move into this new dawn of America, we're also saying perhaps sometimes with our past cheating Tweedo as a president that, you know, here it is right here. You know, sometimes you got to flush twice. So for the Senate, when they go for the impeachment, sometimes you got to flush twice, guys. Anyway, it's a good day. And thank God the last 4 years have disappeared. David, back to you.
Thank you, Bill. Inspiring words as always, and don't forget to flush twice. Goodness me! There's been so many great ideas to come out today, and not everyone will have followed them all. We've gone hopelessly over time, so I really apologize for that. But there's a recording of the session, All of these presentations are going to be available for everyone who's participated, who registered, to have a look at them later. So thanks so much, guys. Thanks so much, Terence Ronson, Ryan Parker, Roger Huey, Matt Carlisle, Chris Snyder, and of course, Bill Burnett. We'll be back with another session over the next couple of weeks. Look forward to seeing you all then. Thanks so much, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.